Hey guys, welcome to this lesson. So in this lesson, we're going to cover files and navigation. Now there's something called the File System Hierarchy Standard, FHS, in Linux. And essentially everything starts from the root, which is the slash. So as I mentioned earlier on, there's no sort of concept of drive letters as we have with Windows, like a C drive or a D drive or an E drive. Instead, the very root of the file system is a forward slash, not a backslash. It's always a forward slash. Then all of the directories that contain the various different operating system files and drivers, as well as our data, sit underneath that. And we can reference them via the path. So for example, the bin folder is under slash. It's directly under the root. This is the binary folder. It's where the program files are actually stored. We have the slash root. That's the home directory for the root user. Slash opt for system libraries and applications. Slash boot for the bootloader. Slash home for the home directory for system users. And within home, there will then be a subdirectory. So it will be slash home slash and then the name of the user typically. So my home folder might be called Neil if my user account is Neil. So we have this set of directories that are set up for us. You can see there's some more here, like the temp directory, the user directory, the proc for virtual files associated with processes in the system. Slash dev is for physical and virtual devices, and so on. And we can actually mount external drives as well as network drives to the slash MNT or the mount directory. So that's the file system hierarchy standard. Now, the way that we're going to interact is typically through a command line interface. Now, Windows also has a CLI. It has both PowerShell, which is very powerful, and it has the command prompt, which has been around for a very, very long time, since the beginning of Windows. Then in Mac, we have something called the terminal. And the terminal in Mac is basically the same thing as we see in Linux. It's almost identical. So you can see here, for example, this is an example of running a terminal on Mac. And I'm doing things like making a directory called my data, changing into that directory, listing the contents of the directory, creating a file and so on. You're going to learn how to do that shortly. So in Linux, it's also a terminal. So basically the same terminology and pretty much the same commands as well. So if you're used to using a command line on Mac, then it's the same for Linux. Now, when we specify our commands, what we have is the whole command, which consists of a list of arguments separated by spaces. So here we have the command. So that could be a specific command like the ls command or the cp command or the mkdir command. Then, depending on the command, there are various different arguments that we can associate with it to manipulate how we want that command to run. Here, for example, we've got the dash o, then we've got the dash dash long dash option minus one, and then a parameter and an argument will come after those. Argument zero is always the command name, so we call that dollar zero here. So that's the actual name of the command that we want to run. Arguments with a dash is basically a short option. Some commands allow combining multiple single character options with one dash. And arguments with a double dash represent long options. So here you can see we have the double dash long dash option. So when we write our commands in the terminal, we need to know how to construct them. Now, firstly, we start with a command name. Then we can have a series of arguments depending on the command that we're running, and these are separated by spaces. For example, arguments with a single hyphen are a short option. So here, for example, we have the ls command. This is the list command with the dash l. Dash l represents long. We also have the long format for our arguments. Here you would have a double hyphen. For example, the ls command with the dash dash format equals long provides the same output. Let's have a look on Ubuntu. So I'm on my Ubuntu desktop here. And if I run the pwd command, print working directory, I can see where I am. I'm in the slash home slash Neil directory. Now if I run the ls command, it's going to list the contents of that directory. And we can see some top level folders here. If I run ls-l, it's going to give me a different format, okay, with a bit more information. But if I run ls-format equals long, that also provides exactly the same output. So often we can use these as a shortcut, okay? This makes life a little bit easier if we just supply one argument. Some options will also take parameters, and some commands will require arguments. You cannot run the command without specifying an argument. Now, you can read the manual. So what is the manual and what is man? If I come back to my command line and I'm going to run the clear command just to clean things up, if I use man and then ls, so if I type man space ls, it's going to take me to the manual. And the manual provides all the different options, all the arguments, and how I can actually represent my commands, how I can construct my commands. So it's a bit of a cheat sheet for that particular utility. I can do the same for lots of different utilities and command line options. So there's a man help file for everything within Linux, all of these different commands within Linux. Now, by the way, we will certainly get into utilizing other tools like ChatGPT as well, because it's so useful for helping us learn the command line on Linux. If you want to do something, if you want to create a command to perform a particular operation and it's difficult, whack it into ChatGPT and it's going to come up with some great results for you. Now, in terms of file system navigation, I've just shown you the ls, that's the list directory contents command, and we've looked at the long listing format. Also, there's the all, that lists all files, including hidden files. So if I come back and type in ls-a, which is the short option, we see that now we have some files that have got a dot in the beginning, and these are actually hidden. Okay, so I had to use the dash a. I can combine a and l to actually get the long format and also show those hidden files. So we can combine the different arguments here. CP is for copying files and directories. We've got the dash r or the dash dash verbose to explain what is being done. So if I come back to the command line here, I'm going to clear screen again. And if I run the touch utility, and I'll create a file called file.txt. Okay, if I run ls now, you can see that I've just created that file by using this touch command, and it's empty. I can use the cat utility to actually view the contents of the file, and there's nothing coming back because it's empty. Now, if I want to create a copy, I can run the command file.txt, file1.txt, and I've now just copied the file, so you can see that now I have two files, and if that had contents, of course, we would have duplicated the contents of the file as well. Move is for moving or renaming files and directories. So rather than creating a copy, then what we're actually doing is moving it from one place to another. And there's a variety of different arguments for that one as well. And rm is for removing files or directories. So we can run rm-f, that's going to force the removal without confirmation. Or rm-recursive is when we want to remove directories and their contents recursively. So be careful with that one. So for example, I could run rm file. Now, if I hit my tab, it's actually going to show me the different options that start with file. If I come back a little bit and just have the F, it's going to fill in file because it's going to take me up to the point where there's some uniqueness. There's multiple options here. If I type in one and then press the tab again, it's going to fill in the name of the file. So that's auto completion. And now I've removed file1.txt. Now, here are some really useful commands to know for file system navigation. And we've actually got lots of these documented for you within this file. So make sure you go to the course download in the section 2 directory, filesandnavigation.md. And you'll open this with Visual Studio Code, which is a free download. So you can just install Visual Studio Code from Microsoft, and then you'll be able to open these files. So let's just go back. I'm just going to play around a little bit here. So mkdir is for making a directory. So I can make a directory called my data. Okay, now when I run ls, guess what? There it is. It's color-coded because it's a directory rather than a file. So now I could, for example, cp my file.txt to my data. And what I want to do here is just fill that in and then put in my data. Okay, so now if I run the ls command on my data, we can see that I've copied my file into it. Now I can cd to change to my data. Okay, so now if I do pwd again, rather than getting all the contents here, I'm actually now within this directory, so I can run ls and I just see the contents of the directory. So I've changed my command line context. That's really important. You've got to remember that when you're running commands, it's basically dependent on where you are. So for example, from here, I can run rm file.txt and it's going to delete that file. Okay, but if I run touch test file.txt. So now I actually have that file, but I change up a directory and I try to rm testfile.txt. Of course, it's going to error because in my current location, there is no testfile.txt. So now if I want to delete it, I have to run rm my data testfile.txt. So understanding the context of your command line is very important. So there's a few exercises in here. I'm not going to go through all of these because this is more for you to do after this lesson, but I recommend that you go through each of these different exercises and just make sure that you're comfortable with these commands. They're fairly straightforward, but they're very, very important. Other utilities that are very useful are, for example, more. And we'll have a look at how we can pipe to more shortly, and you'll understand what I mean when we get there. Now, there are hidden directories which are not shown with the ls command, and we've just seen that before. They're hidden by having a dot in front of their name, and they're not secret directories, they're just hidden from view. So we can actually create our own hidden directories if we like as well by simply putting a dot in front of the name. So for basic navigation, cd is changing directories. If we run cd by itself, it will take us back to our home directory. So let's go back to the command line here. And let's see where I am, pwd. I'm in my home directory and I've got a folder called my data. So let's change directory into my data. Now I'm in a different location. If I just run cd, pwd again, and now I'm back up at home/Neil. So let's go back to my data. Another way I could do that is using the tilde. Change directory tilde. And guess what? Again, I'm back in my home directory. Now, we can use what's called the absolute path from the root of the file system, or the relative path from where we are. So what does that mean? So let's come back to the command line. I'm just going to clear my screen here. I'm going to change back to my home directory. And I have my data, and I'm going to create a file in my data, and let's call that photo.jpg. Now, what is the absolute path to photo.jpg? Well, if I go into my data and pwd, we can see the path to my data, /home/Neil/my data, and then it will be /photo.jpg. Now, I can go anywhere on the file system. I can go to the root of the file system, and I can use a utility like cat. In fact, that won't actually show any contents because we don't have any contents in that file. So let me instead show you how to remove that file. So I'm going to remove that file, but without changing my location. So one way to do that is the absolute path. So the absolute path would be /home/Neil/my data/photo.jpg. Okay, now I can delete that file. That's the absolute path all the way from the root down to the actual file itself. Now, if I'm actually in home Neil my data, so for that I can cd and then change directory to my data. And now if I just create a file again called photo.jpg, of course here, all I need to do is rm photo.jpg and it's going to delete it. But if I go back up a level, and by the way, another way to do that is cd dot dot. That takes me up one level, which in this case puts me back in my home directory. So now if I want to delete photo.jpg, I could use the absolute path like this, or I could use the relative path, which is, well, I'm in my data. Sorry, I'm in my home directory here. So in my home directory, I would do rm my data photo.jpg. That's the relative path from where I am at the moment. So it's relative to the location where you are in the file system. We've also got pipes and redirection. A pipe allows us to deliver the output of one command as the input to a following command. So this file would print the contents of file one and then sort those contents. This command would pipe the output of this netstat command, which will actually bring up all the open ports and connections on the system, to the grep utility, which can be used to actually sort the output or search the output for a specific string or variable. So this one would show you which process is using port 80 on the system. So let's go over and see these in action. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change to the var log directory. Let's have a look in here. We've got some log files. Now, for example, I might be able to view some information in the boot.log file. And it says permission denied. Now, when we see this, one thing we can do is run the sudo command. Okay, sudo switches user. You might need to enter your password. Sudo elevates our permissions. So it's very useful for temporary elevation of our permissions. Now you can see it provided lots of output here, more than one screen. So what I could do is, and let me just bring this back up so you can see more easily. Here's the command. What I'll do this time is I'm going to pipe the output to the more utility. That's going to show me one screen at a time. You see that I've got more in the bottom left-hand corner, and I can press the space bar to go through. So that's really useful. The other command that we saw in the examples there was the netstat command. Now, netstat needs to be installed using the installation, sudo apt install nettools. We'll get onto package managers later. But if I just run this command, it's going to install some network utilities. Now, I should be able to run netstat. And it shows me all of the processes and the connections to this system. So if I wanted to, maybe for some reason, I need to find the process that is running for some specific protocol. Okay, so I could search through here. Maybe it's this one. It's the one using this 8184. So now I could pipe to grep and search for that text string, 8184, I think that was. And there you go. Now it just shows me the exact output that I'm looking for. We can also redirect the output somewhere else. So this allows us to modify the default input and or output of the shell. In this example, what we're doing is we're reading file one and then outputting the information to file two. Input redirection is done by using this command. It's like a sort of pointer going backwards. So let's try that out. What I'm going to do is go back to my home directory. So here I am in my home directory. And this time I'm going to echo my test file. And I'm going to forward that to testfile.txt. And if I cat testfile.txt, we can see the words my test file echoing, just echo this text string, and I forwarded it into testfile.txt. Now, when I'm running the cat utility, it's showing the contents. And I could forward that to file2.txt. And now, if I cat file2.txt, we're going to have the same input, or the same output rather, because we forwarded the output of one command into a different one. In this case, copying the contents into file2.txt.